Saturday marks the sixth anniversary of the death of Kansas City baseball icon Buck O'Neill. The Royals still honor him today with the Buck O'Neill seat at Kauffman Stadium. And now there are efforts to turn Buck's former home into a museum. The Kansas City Star reports that Buck bequeathed his two-story home on 32nd Street in Kansas City's historic Santa Fe neighborhood to his church after his death, and they now want to turn it into a museum honoring his life and legacy. But the house needs about $100,000 worth of repairs, even before adding exhibits, while the effort to preserve an historic home seems laudable. Doesn't this seem like an uphill battle when the museums at 18th and Vine continue to struggle, Eric Wesson?
That's not going to be a museum. The church wants to use it for a Section 8 property. There was another group that came in that did the renovations. They want to use it as a housing unit for 3rd District City Council people. The Negro Leagues Museum is like, the name Buck O'Neill belongs to us. We do the fundraising under that name. Then you have Mr. Gates and the Education Center saying, I can't use Buck's name to raise money, so how are they going to use it to raise money as well?
Now, but the Star article, though, did say they were going to make it into a museum to honor Buck O'Neill. So the baseball museum won't allow that?
No, the baseball museum's board member said if Buck wanted us to have that house and be a museum, he would have left it to us. He left it to the church. The church's agenda is to turn it into Section 8 housing so they can generate income. The nonprofit group that developed and started to renovate houses said that they wanted Jermaine Reed and Melba Curl to use it for housing for the 3rd District as an office for them to connect to the community. No one knows who the Star talked to that said that they wanted to turn that house into a museum.
Ah, so we found a difference there. You were actually investigating the whole 18th and Vine area yourself, Stacey Cameron, earlier this summer when you were dealing with that whole area. How is that area doing at this point in time?
Well, the area is doing fine in terms of it doesn't own any money in terms of bonds that were floated. There's only been about $70 million put into that district. However, that district is poorly managed in terms of marketing. We haven't seen an explosion of tourism down there. We have infighting on the board. We have multiple directions that different people want to go. We see properties like the Gym Theater and the Blue Note that aren't adequately used in the neighborhood to bring in national touring acts. So there's a lot to be left desired down there, and it's a simply, from what I have seen in conversations I've had since that investigation, the people that should be accountable don't want to be accountable, and it's a difficult knot to unwind down there. And so if that house were to be turned into a museum, I would hope that private sector would take that over, and not anything that's government or quasi-government.
When you get into 18th Street, I think JDRC did a search to have somebody come in and manage the rest of the properties down there. 18th and Vine has an identity problem. It doesn't know whether it wants to be an entertainment district, a restaurant district,
housing, or
housing. But I hope that sometime soon they develop that, because we need some grocery stores and restaurants down there.
It seems in many ways at 18th and Vine, it's one step forward, two back. You remember when Emanuel Cleaver was mayor, he took a lot of criticism for authorizing the purchase of Charlie Parker's saxophone for $40,000. The Peachtree moved out and moved into the Power and Light District, which ironically at the time was being accused of discouraging black patronage, and that was a big, big blow.